her oncologist came and said the chemotherapy wasn't doing what it was supposed to. They were going to recommend us to start considering full body radiation and a bone marrow transplant. So that day we gave her her first dose of cannabis oil. 6 days later, it was in full remission.
When we talk about a war on drugs, what we're really talking about is a war on some drugs. So many of the drugs we now classify as illegal, from speed to ketamine, were originally created as medicines. Aspirin and heroin were first commercially synthesized in 1897, in the same lab in Germany, just 2 weeks apart. And it was heroin that was originally expected to have the most potential medical uses. So, where is the line between medicine and the so-called dangerous illicit drugs? In this episode, we're looking at how, for almost a century, the war on drugs has prevented people getting the medicines they need and caused untold suffering in the process.
They used to have me on so many pain pills, a lot of opiates and muscle relaxers, and I was on over 40 medications until I started using cannabis. Now I'm down to 2.
The earliest stories we have of cannabis being used as a medicine date back to ancient China, around 2700 BC. Since then, weed has been used to treat illness pretty much constantly, from Islamic doctors in the Middle Ages to providing effective, affordable pain relief right through the 1900s. This all changed in the early 20th century with the rise of opiate-based pain medication and a massively racist campaign by US law enforcement, which led to cannabis being shut out of Western medical texts. In 1970, cannabis was placed in Schedule 1 of America's Controlled Substances Act, meaning that despite 4,500 years of evidence to the contrary, it was deemed to have no currently accepted medical use.
I've met a lot of them who, they will tell you, I can't prescribe it, but you should try it. Don't tell anybody I'm saying this, you know? And that's a shame because they're medical professionals and their hands are tied.
In the face of massive demand, California broke with federal law and legalized medical cannabis in 1996, and Canada became the first country to allow it in 2001. Currently, 36 states and 4 territories across the US allow medical marijuana, but across the rest of the world, progress is painfully slow. The UK is the world's biggest exporter of medical cannabis, but until 2018, actually accessing the medicine in Britain itself was all but impossible. And that only changed thanks to the staggering efforts of a few desperate families.
My son Billy has intractable epilepsy and autism, and at 4 months old, he took his first seizure. They tried every anti-epileptic pharmaceutical and they weren't working. He had escalated into having 200, 300 seizures per day. I discovered a doctor in Chicago who was an expert in epilepsy. So Professor Nordley said, have you ever thought about trying cannabis oil? September 2016 started his journey basically on medical cannabis. He was doing incredibly well until May 2018. Billy's GP was taken to a hotel in Belfast by the powers that be and told not to prescribe any more medical cannabis for Billy Caldwell.
But Charlotte wasn't going to let the government get away with this. With help from the organization Vaultface, she found a specialist doctor in Canada and flew out with Billy to get the medication he needed.
We came up to the customs and I declared everything. The guy came back. He said, I am so sorry. I'm a daddy myself. I don't want to take this, but I have to.
By this point, the optics of Billy being rushed to hospital, having been deliberately denied the medicine he needed, was too much even for the British Home Office. The decision was reversed almost overnight. Billy got his medicine and the law officially changed a few months later. It was a powerful testament to what one family can do when they won't give up.
Doctors can now write prescriptions in the UK. That is in law. Another reason why we've launched the I Am Billy campaign is because there is huge barriers around patients in the UK accessing medical cannabis.
The whole point of Britain's National Health Service is that people get the medical help they need free at the point of delivery. But with cannabis-based medicine, that stops being true. Medical cannabis is technically legal, but only specialist doctors can prescribe it. People who can afford it can go to private clinics, but people who don't have the money are shut out. Meanwhile, recent data shows that 1.4 million people in the UK are using cannabis illegally to treat their own medical conditions.
We have a government that said we're not going to accept any medical value to this. They want the money on this side, but the people that are sick here can't get it.
So people who are sick and who want this have to come to you. They have to get medicine that's made on a hot plate.
Yeah. We don't charge. It's not about charging, you know.
How much do you give away?
Every week about 20,000. But for someone, that could be like 5 to 10 days of relief. And this is why we're actually fighting our government for the right for medical access, because it shouldn't be people like me sitting in a dank little house, risking my life and my freedom.
Benzodiazepines are minor tranquilizers. They've been around since the early 60s and are used to treat everything from anxiety and insomnia to alcohol withdrawal. Diazepam, originally marketed as Valium, was widely prescribed for decades, inspiring the Rolling Stones song Mother's Little Helper and the cult movie Valley of the Dolls. But benzos can be dangerous. They're addictive, and when mixed with other drugs, especially downers like opiates or alcohol, can greatly increase the risk of overdose. Even before Trainspotting, Scotland was traditionally associated with two drugs, alcohol and heroin. But in the past few years, an entirely new crisis has emerged, pushing Scottish drug death rates to by far the highest in Europe. And this particular crisis has been almost entirely caused by how the war on drugs impacts the medical world.
That's Xanax. That's Valium.
For the last 30 years, I've been involved in drugs in one way or another, from a user to somebody who's working now in the field. And I've just never experienced or seen anything quite like what we've got going on just now.
But what happened in Scotland was less about the dangers of these drugs and more about the dangers of the government trying to deal with addiction in all the wrong ways. The problems really started in 2010. The Scottish government decided to adopt a just say no approach to drugs, a move to restrict doctors from prescribing Valium. Prescription rates declined and long-term users had their supplies cut off almost overnight. But people didn't just magically stop needing the drugs because the government said so. All that the restriction of medical supply achieved was to open a massive opportunity for dealers on the black market.
There's no surprise to me that when doctors and prescribing services stopped prescribing benzodiazepines, we created this illicit market. If anybody goes into Glasgow, you literally just need to stand next to a homeless person for 10 minutes, and then you will get kids as young as 14 or 15 going by wanting a street Valium pal.
Instead of Valium use going down, it rocketed up. And this wasn't medically controlled under doctor's supervision. This was street level use with black market pills cheap and easy to get hold of. Drug workers who were used to hearing people talk about taking one or two pills a day were hearing of them taking one or two handfuls of pills a day.
I got 30 for £10.
30 for £10?
Yep.
30 pence a pill. Are you addicted?
Yeah. That's well 80 a day.
80 Valiums a day?
Yeah, I've had 80 a day already.
This is what happens when you move from a regulated medical market to an unregulated criminal one. But there was another element of the war on drugs that helped cause chaos in Scotland. As well as adopting a just say no approach to prescribing, the Scottish National Party also heavily cut funding to drug treatment services at exactly the same time. From 2010, there were decreases in funding every year, followed by a massive 22% cut in 2015. This all came together to create a perfect storm in Scotland. And then, in 2015, everything got even worse.
Six friends have died in the space of 3 weeks.
And that's not enough to make you stop?
No. There's something in them that's different from normal Valium that, wow, no, it's horrible. It's not good at all.
Do you crave them?
Crave? You've got to get them or you can't function right.
The original wave of black market diazepam in Scotland had been imported from India and China. It was around 2015 that local gangs realised they didn't have to go abroad. They could make the pills themselves. They also realised they didn't have to make actual diazepam at all. Pills pressed in backstreet labs and marketed on the street as Valium were found to contain a host of other, often much stronger, forms of benzodiazepines and synthetic opiates. Most deadly of all has been the explosion of atezolam. This has a shorter half-life than Valium, meaning people use more of it, which suits the gangs that sell it just fine. If you look at this graph of drug deaths in Scotland, the blue line showing deaths involving atezolam from 2015 is almost vertical.
Now that's a direct correlation between services and GPs. We've got hundreds of thousands of pills being pressed in Scotland now. You know, they're just getting flooded into the streets. We don't know what's in them. Every single time they get pressed, something different is in them. But the reality is that a decision needs to be made. What is more dangerous just now, the illicit market, which nobody knows what's in it, or the prescribed, regulated, controlled medical market? For me, it's not rocket science. Scotland's a terrible drug death rate, 15 times higher than the EU average, is purely down to bad policy decisions.
In some ways, what happened in Scotland has mirrored the situation of the opioid crisis in North America. Restrictions in the medical supply, combined with ineffective just-say-no drug treatment, drive people onto the black market. Then criminal gangs quickly realize they can make vast profits by pushing these drugs and by using cheaper, stronger chemicals. And then people start dying. In Scotland, they've impressively managed to produce this outcome without the added pressure of a massively corrupt US pharmaceutical industry. But the underlying problem is the same. The problem is the war on drugs.
The pain is like someone stabbing you with a needle all over your body and joints. That's how it feels. Because of morphine, I am surviving. Life without morphine, for me, is unthinkable.
90% of the world's medical morphine is used by the richest 10% of its population. If you live in Europe or North America and you get diagnosed with a serious illness, you should at least be relatively sure that you'll be given medication to manage the pain. But because of the war on drugs, there is a massive undersupply of medical morphine across the global south, meaning millions upon millions of people are forced to suffer in needless agony. In 2011, the World Health Organization estimated that 5.5 million terminal cancer patients and a further million AIDS patients would die without receiving any pain medication whatsoever. This is the world's other opioid crisis.
She has severe pain. She can't sleep at night.
Fatima's family says she shouts in agony day and night. But because of strict narcotics laws, morphine, the gold standard in pain treatment, is nearly impossible to get in most of India.
Of the 1.3 billion people in India, less than 2% has access to pain relief. This situation arose possibly out of a draconian law passed in 1985 to curb abuse. It effectively prevented medical access. Now, two generations of doctors have grown up without seeing a tablet of morphine. Among the medical professionals, among the public, and among the regulators, there's an unrealistic opiophobia. In India and in much of the low and middle income countries, the punishment for a drug offense, as they call it, can be very harsh.
India is a particularly shocking case. The country is the world's largest producer of legal opium for the pharmaceutical industry. Yet provision of medical morphine for Indian citizens themselves is virtually non-existent. In India, a patient in palliative care is on average allocated 43 milligrams of morphine. In Canada, that figure is 68,194 milligrams. That's an increase of over 1,500%.
There is a significant inequity in access to healthcare generally in my country, but it's very obvious in the case of pain management. If you break a leg, if you have an operation on the stomach, if you have a serious accident, or if you have a disease like cancer, you get prescribed paracetamol, something like your ibuprofen, etc., which will be nowhere near enough. Now, this is horrendous and causes unimaginable suffering.
You can trace this mass suffering of patients in India straight back to the war on drugs. In 1985, India changed its law to come in line with the 1961 UN Single Convention on Narcotic Drugs. Between then and 1997, medical morphine consumption dropped 97% to just 18 kilograms for the entire country. Out of 300 medical colleges in the country, only 5 trained doctors to prescribe opioids as part of palliative care. And it's not just India. Right across the global south, millions of people are forced to suffer horrendous pain needlessly, directly because of the drug war. Across sub-Saharan Africa, children with burns all over their bodies are rarely even given paracetamol. In Indonesia, people go through chemotherapy with nothing but over-the-counter painkillers. If this was happening in any developed country, there would be outrage. The war on drugs causes many harms across the world. imprisoning people, destroying their livelihoods, and leading to rampant crime and corruption. But surely, a situation where millions of people are forced to die in agony, something that could be so easily prevented, is simply too grotesque to ignore.